Okay, looks like we're doing neutron stars, my friends.
Neutron stars are one of the most extreme and violent things in the universe. Giant atomic nuclei, only a few kilometers in diameter, but as massive as stars. And they owe their existence to the death of something majestic. Stars exist because of a fragile balance. The mass of millions of billions of tons of hot plasma are being pulled inwards by gravity and squeeze material together with so much force that nuclei fuse. Hydrogen fuses into helium. This releases energy which pushes against gravity and tries to escape. As long as this balance exists, stars are pretty stable. Eventually, the hydrogen will be exhausted. Medium stars like our Sun go through a giant phase where they burn helium into carbon and oxygen before they eventually turn into white dwarfs. But in stars many...
We've done red dwarf video, white dwarf video coming. If you're new around here, a new kind of VPN called a post-quantum VPN. It can literally protect you from quantum computers thanks to things called post-quantum algorithms that are inside this baby. This is made with open source software. And you can go read on the internet in the description, and if you want to use it for free, you can. So you can go use the alpha for free right now. This is the beta version, so it looks a little bit different. This version, beta, comes out this week, and you'll get a free month. Currently, it's only available on Windows, by the way. But you know, the Mac version we're developing starting from the end of this week. Anyway.
Many times the mass of our Sun, things get interesting when the helium is exhausted. For a moment, the balance of pressure and radiation tips and gravity wins, squeezing the star tighter than before. The core burns hotter and faster, while the outer layers of the star swell by hundreds of times, fusing heavier and heavier elements. Carbon burns to neon in centuries, neon to oxygen in a year, oxygen to silicon in months, and silicon to iron in a day.
And find
then,
out.
Death. Iron is nuclear ash. It has no energy to give and cannot be fused.
Nuclear ash, that's a cool way of putting it. Yeah, you can't fuse iron. It basically actually takes energy. so what happens then is the core of the star, as soon as you run out of the other stuff, it just, the core collapses, right? And that results in a very interesting thing.
The fusion suddenly stops and the balance ends. Without the outward pressure from fusion, the core is crushed by the enormous weight of the star above it. What happens now is awesome and scary. Particles like electrons and protons really don't want to be near each other. But the pressure...
Well, you just got to think about this, right? Because at the center, you had a nuclear fusion reaction pushing out. Right? There's lots of energy. But you had this huge amount of mass. You got gravity pushing inwards. So what happens when the core suddenly stops pushing out and collapses, right? Stops producing energy, essentially. Well, it collapses, right? Because you have gravity trying to crush it the whole time. Like you said, it's a delicate balance between, you know, gravity trying to squish it as well as fusion. So, yeah.
The pressure of the collapsing star is so great that electrons and protons fuse into neutrons, which then get squeezed together as tightly as in atomic nuclei. An iron ball the size of the Earth is squeezed into a ball of pure nuclear matter the size of a city.
It actually is like somewhat becomes like a giant atom in a way because, yeah, the neutrons are pushed so close together that they're like kind of almost touching, right? And it's like a neutron star is just kind of like a ball of neutrons.
But not just the core, the whole star implodes, gravity pulling the outer layers in at 25% the speed of light. This implosion bounces off the iron core, producing a shockwave that explodes outwards and catapults the rest of the star into space. This is what we call a supernova explosion, and it will outshine entire galaxies. What remains of the star is now a neutron star. Its mass is around...
Not always. So a supernova can also result in black holes, you might know. You know, if the star is large enough, you know, that collapse of the core, right, can result in the, you know, more layers collapsing. And that basically, you know, squishes stuff beyond its Schwarzschild radius. And at that point, reality, like space-time, just is like, nope, not doing that anymore, mate. I'm out of here. And then there's a hole in the universe, in a sense, because, you know, things start to go, you know, like, inwards. And we think there could be a singularity in there. Black holes are way more mysterious. We don't really understand them. We understand, like, kind of the outside and what's happening around them, kind of. Still lots of mysteries. But yeah, anyway, I forgot to mention as well, because remember I said, you know, the outside sort of collapses in. And then you might be like, well, he just showed it a supernova, it expands. That's because there's like a brief collapse and then it goes bang, right? It goes like in and then out. And there's also multiple events that actually happen. It's not as simple as this, right? Like there's like flashes that get let off at certain points. There's all kinds of things that actually go that happen if you go into astrophysics and look at this. There's a lot, right? It's not this simple. But this is kind of just, you know, talking about the main fun things.
A million times the mass of the Earth, but compressed to an object about 25 kilometers wide. It's so dense that the mass of all living humans would fit into 1 cubic centimeter of neutron star matter. That...
Don't do that, guys. That would be mean.
It's roughly a billion...
But, yeah, I also always like to say, like a little teaspoon of neutron star apparently weighs as much as Mount Everest. I mean, if you make the calculation, you can verify that, but that's what everyone says, at least.
And tons in a space the size of a sugar cube. Put another way, that's Mount Everest in a cup of coffee.
There you go.
From the outside, a neutron star is unbelievably extreme. Its gravity is the strongest outside black holes, and if it were any denser, it would...
He's saying the strongest of like known stars. There's lots we don't know out there, right? And there's lots of theoretical stars that could exist that we don't know about. And he's actually, you might have heard of a magnetar, which actually, you know, the magnetic field around those things is actually more intense. But a magnetar is literally just a pulsar, right? Just with a really strong magnetic field. Well, we can talk about magnetars soon. We actually have realized recently that might be what FRBs are, fast radio bursts. Very mysterious things we thought might have been aliens, but it's never aliens, unfortunately.
Become one. Light is bent around it, meaning you can see the front and parts of the back. Their surfaces reach 1,000,000 degrees Celsius compared to a measly 6,000 degrees for our sun. Okay, let's look inside a neutron star. Although these giant atomic nuclei are stars, in many ways they're also like planets with solid crusts over a liquid core. The crust is extremely hard. The outermost layers are made of iron left over from the supernova, squeezed together in a crystal lattice with a sea of electrons flowing through them. Going deeper, gravity squeezes nuclei closer together. We find fewer and fewer protons as most merge to neutrons, until we reach the base of the crust. Here, nuclei are squeezed together so hard that they start to touch. Protons and neutrons rearrange, making long cylinders or sheets, enormous nuclei with millions of protons and neutrons shaped like spaghetti and lasagna, which physicists call nuclear pasta. Nuclear pasta is so dense that it may be the strongest material in the universe, basically unbreakable. Lumps of pasta inside a neutron star can even make mountains, at most a few centimeters high, but many times as massive as the Himalayas. Eventually, beneath the pasta, we reach the core. We're not really sure what the properties of matter are when they're squeezed this hard. Protons and neutrons might dissolve.
So we talk about this in other videos, but you might ask, how the hell do we know this? Well, it has a lot to do with computer simulations, right? You know, you put these in computer simulations and, you know, they seem to look like what they do in reality. And then we make predictions from the computer simulations. Reality matches the simulations and we go, okay, maybe, you know, we're onto something here. But not just that way, you know, theoretically as well, we do calculations.
Dissolve into an ocean of quarks, a so-called quark gluon plasma. Some of those quarks might turn into strange quarks, making a sort of strange matter with properties so extreme that we made a whole video about it. Or maybe
we've watched that one.
Maybe they just stay protons and neutrons. No one knows for sure, and that's why we do science. That's all pretty heavy stuff, literally, so let's go back out into space. When neutron stars...
So there might be phases beyond even a neutron star, but it doesn't look like it from what we can see. You know, there could be quark stars, strange stars, And there's some other weird things as well. So anyway.
First collapse, they begin to spin very, very fast, like a ballerina pulling her arms in. Neutron stars are celestial ballerinas spinning many times per second. This creates pulses because their magnetic field creates a beam of radio waves which passes every time they spin.
Okay, that's not a perfect explanation, right? So have you heard of a pulsar, right? If you're confused what the hell... So a pulsar and a neutron star are the same thing, okay? We call them a pulsar when... So like you said, there are these jets and they actually come at the poles, right? Just like that. So, if we imagine the, neutron star, pulsar, jets coming out perpendicular at the poles. And when those poles are pointing at us, so as he mentioned, they rotate rapidly, right? So as they spin, these poles, the jets of stuff that's coming out at these poles at, nearly the speed of light, they get spun around because the star's spinning. And if you spin it in a certain way, it actually goes like this. So we can look this up. And so those whip around and sometimes they, hit Earth, right? And that's what we call a pulsar, when it when it whips and hits us. And these things are really, 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 they happen very regularly. Like, we could use these things as things that are nearly as precise as atomic clocks for measuring time, for instance. And we actually might be able to use these for GPS devices, for like interstellar GPS. So that's not how we currently do it, but I think this is probably the future of GPS.
These radio pulsars are the best known type of neutron star. About 2,000 are known of in the Milky Way. These magnetic fields are the strongest in the universe, a quadrillion times stronger than Earth's after they're born. They're called magnetars until they calm down a little. But the absolute best kind of neutron stars are friends with other neutron stars. By radiating away energy as gravitational waves, ripples in space-time, their orbits can decay and they can crash into and kill each other in a kilonova explosion that spews out a lot of their guts. When they do, the conditions become so extreme that for a moment, heavy nuclei are made again. It's not fusion putting nuclei together this time, but heavy neutron-rich matter falling apart and reassembling. Only very recently, we've learned that this is probably the origin of most of the heavy elements in the universe, like gold, uranium and platinum, and dozens more. So they're now two neutron stars.
So next time you get like a gold ring or a gold anything, just remember that might probably came from a colliding neutron stars. That's not cool, I don't know what is.
Collapse and become a black hole, dying yet again. Not only do stars have to die to create elements, they have to die twice. Over millions of years, these atoms will mix back into the galaxy, but some of them end up in a cloud which gravity pulls together to form stars and planets, repeating the cycle. Our solar system is one example, and the remains of those neutron stars that came before us are all around us. Our entire technological modern world was built out of the elements neutron stars made in eons past, sending these atoms on a 13 billion year journey to come together and make us and our world. And that's pretty cool. Until
that is pretty cool. I agree. Go get Kurzgesagt's calendar because they're legends. And I think that's that video. So that was fun.